Welcome everybody to today's session. My name is Daria Eker. I'm R&D manager at Processors IP Group at Synopsys. Today I'll be talking about the power estimation challenges in vision SoCs. Low power has been always a hot topic in any product. So over the past years and today, the question remains the same. How much performance you can fit to a given area? Does it fit in your power budget, and is the cost acceptable? Yet, things start becoming more interesting challenges as more and more products are starting introducing artificial intelligence. So understanding specifics of this application domain is also the key to get it right when it comes to power estimation. In this presentation, I will be covering the following topics: domain-specific challenges, power estimation pitfalls, and best practices. At the end of the session, we'll have a Q&A slot. You can submit your questions throughout the presentation, and end of the presentation, I'll try to address them. The field of artificial intelligence has seen significant growth over the past years, specifically from 2012 onwards with the advances in deep neural networks. The algorithmic advantage of deep neural networks comes with complexity in computation and memory cost. So this exposes specific challenges to the hardware platforms that executing to them. So the need of processing more data and to deal with the complexity and increasing performance in the algorithms, you need to be designing for high performance systems, yet also energy efficient ones, both at the cloud and at the edge. Let's look at a typical use case in vision processing in automotive. So you have images coming in, uncompressed video frames coming in, and you need to know if it's a cyclist or not. So in a typical neural network application, you'll train your system to get the decision of a cyclist. So how do you accomplish that? You need to move all the data to memory, typically to LPDDR memory for power reasons. And from there, you'll be moving chunks of images data to the vision processing unit. These vision processing units, typically they get dedicated accelerators to do convolutional neural network processing. So you could think of these accelerators as big MAT functions that are able to do efficient MAC operations and do other compute operations. So you need this computation to get to the decision of cyclist. As the algorithm complexity increases, the amount of weights and activations that needs to be computed per CNN graph layer will be also increasing. So this implies that you will not be able to store all this data in the local memories, but you might need to store it in either on-chip SRAM or DRAM. This requires more accesses to external bus and to external memory. So this has power implications. Alternatively, you can increase the memory size to fit more of these weights locally, and therefore reduce of the need to going to external memories. However, this also increases your area, therefore your cost. So you need to make these trade-offs between the cost versus the power and the bandwidth optimizations. In addition to the complex algorithm complexity, there could be other factors that are driving the performance. For example, you might need to be processing higher image resolution frames, for example, full HD. Your number of cameras and sensors might be increasing, or you might need to actually going to higher frame rates. This all the need of amount of data and compute requires more performance. to reach more performance, to start with, you might be adding actually more max. And to feed this max efficiently, you might need to actually increase your bandwidth. And increasing bandwidth might imply that you need to actually access to external memory, which in return will increase your power consumption. Note that at the system context, accesses to DRAM might be actually contribute almost 50% of your old power consumption. So this the drive for higher performance and the has to be balanced with the power implications. So designs need to scale and cope with these performance needs. This implies that the billions of transistors might be consuming significant amount of power. And this power consumption is also not limited to only, and the concerns about the power consumption is also not only limited to battery operated devices such as smartphones. For example, you have more and more cloud-based solutions. And therefore, there's the number of data centers are increasing. The power consumption of a single rack in a data center has a big impact actually on the cost efficiency of these data centers. These days, the most of the expenses goes to air conditioning and cooling. The overall energy impact of the data centers that can go up to 1 to 1.5% of global electricity usage. So these are significant numbers. So reducing the energy footprint of data centers by lowering the power consumption is also very critical and key. Another example that you could think of is in cars. So power would not be thought as a critical criteria and could be a concern if it comes to automotive. However, for example, in the case of electrical cars, if your autonomous computing platform will be consuming too much power, that will be impacting your driving range. Or if you'll be exceeding the power budget, if you did not dimension right because your power estimation was not correct, you might be dealing actually physical failures that will be causing reliability issues, which is not acceptable in, especially in safety critical systems. So power and low power and being in the power budget is key across different products and market segments. So there is a continuous trade-off, system trade-off for getting that amount of performance in a fixed power budget. Because at the end of the day, Detana, you have the thermal limit. So you have to really have the fit into your power budget and your performance needs to scale accordingly. So while this kind of system trades off and the concerns in power has been around and is the same for today's, especially high-end SoCs, AI introduces additional challenges. The algorithm complexity and the pace that actually these algorithms and their performance requirements are evolving are very fast. So designs need to be actually flexible to cope with this fast pace. Designers must need to evaluate, analyze power frequently, weekly, often sometimes even daily, to check if your design is on target and within your power budget. Typically, these designs are physically large. So your implementation tools and power estimation tools that need to work on big data. And this exposes challenges in run times and simulation times. So while taking these things into consideration, your development processes, tools, approaches also need to be adapted accordingly. It's key to actually take this into account and to have actually predictable power results across your product development when you also get to sign off. So in the world of AI inference engines, there are a number of metrics that are quoted to evaluate across the board. So let's look at each and every of these metrics, and also somewhere that, you know, what are the shortcomings of these metrics. As illustrated in the slide, in these equations, the goal of low power is to reduce each component that is contributing to power. So the lower power consumption of each component, therefore the overall power will be lower. Power has two main components, dynamic power and static power. Dynamic power is comprised of switching power and the short circuit rated power. And the static power is related to leakage current, which is the current that's flowing through transistors even there is no switching activity. Each of these components are affected greatly by a number of factors. Switching activity, capacitance, supply voltage, frequency, and the technology-related parameters. So while doing a power estimation benchmarking, these all things that are affecting your quality of results, and you need to be taking this explicitly in your estimations. In this overview, we see the impact of technology on power. As we move on to smaller technology nodes, the dynamic power starts reducing. On the other hand, as the technology nodes getting smaller, the static power starts becoming more and more dominant, especially if you go to automotive processes and the leakage current, the static power starts becoming dominant and problematic. In addition to this, in the same technology node, you might have a wide range of different cells that you can use in your implementation. For example, if you want to reach higher frequencies, you might be choosing to use lower threshold voltage cells. While this is helping you to achieve higher frequency, therefore higher performance, in return that you have a high increase leakage current, your static power is increasing, and which not might be also acceptable. So you have to balance the implementation details and the choices that you're making versus the impact on power and performance. So getting more performance out of technology, in a sense, if it comes to power, is also not for free. We have seen that each and every component how that's affecting power, absolute power. Let's look at the total power in the case of across different IP architectures while running a similar workload. In this example, you see up to 2x difference results. Absolute power without additional information and giving any context can be interpreted in multiple ways. You need to be knowing more about to actually judge these results, if the low power is something that meets actually your system requirements. You're meeting this power on the realistic workloads. Having for apple-to-apple comparison, if we would fix the technology parameters and frequency, what is not known is the switching activity. So the switching activity across these benchmarks might be changing based on number of conditions. For example, one of the IPs would be utilizing the hardware in a different way. In this case, max in the system might be utilized inefficiently. Max might be, for example, waiting to be fed with the information, right, the data, because it has to be to reach the throughput. You need to be potentially accessed externally, and you might have actually the idle cycles, which while consuming less power in these cycles, overall actually efficiency will be less. So actual system utilization has impact of absolute power, but also it's something says about your efficiency of your system. So you need to know more about the system context, the performance, to really actually say something about the power. So we looked at how power is varying across different IP architectures running the same workload. Total power also might be varying on the same IP architecture across different benchmarks. In this example that you also see, the absolute power is changing across these applications. While this is making it obvious that if your design would fit in the power budget while running different applications, right? Absolute power would fit in the power budget. It doesn't say how these applications efficiently mapped or not. So you need to link the power to a system performance to really evaluate in a complete and comprehensive way your system efficiency. One of the commonly metrics that used to evaluate the performance of the AI inference engines is tera operations per second. It states that the maximum achievable throughput under available max at the given target frequency. For example, if you have 2000 max in your design and you'll be running running at 1 gigahertz, it implies that you have your performance on is for tops. If you have your design is with the typical conditions designed, and if you'll be targeting synthesizing your design for the worst case conditions, your frequency will be going down. This means actually that your performance will go down. So for the same design, that actually your performance target will be varying as well. So it's important to absolutely state the exact conditions that the performance metrics are given. Another aspect of that the commonly used metrics is the assumption is the peak throughput, assuming the almost up to 100% Mac utilization. Realistically, is the Mac utilization is something you will not be constant and will not be same across also different applications. So you need to take the performance metrics also need to be explicitly mentioning what are the underlying assumptions to make it more realistic. So we need to link the system performance to power to really evaluate the energy efficiency of a given design. So another commonly used metrics is tops per watt. So you have these two components and you've seen the different things that are affecting and mattering for these metrics. So tops per watt is a good and realistic metrics if these metrics are measured under the achievable, realistic conditions, such as the Mac utilization should be actual measured and achievable one, but the throughput that in a peak one, 100% is not to be expected when you're in a very realistic workload and across different applications. So you have to actually link this also to more system utilization, Mac utilization, to make it more realistic and meaningful. Mentioned that how important actually and it's how much the Mac utilization is affect the energy efficiency. In this example that you see different Mac utilization across different applications and how the energy efficiency is scaling. While the higher Mac utilization might mean higher absolute power, this also implies a higher energy efficiency, which is good. On the other hand, low Mac utilization might mean that actually that the low absolute power, this also implies that in a lower energy efficiency. So you need to you need to add multiple angles to really evaluate efficiency of a given design. So we have looked at the different aspects of the metrics, the importance of the conditions and the for making this actually metrics realistic and as complete as possible. Another factor that is important is the stimuli. Your power estimation is as good as how your stimuli is. The more realistic your data is. Let's look at some examples how your results will vary across different use cases. So power estimation depends on also switching activity. Therefore, your input stimuli. So running realistic workloads means that your power estimation will be also close to what you will get in real life. In this example that then we're looking at ResNet 50, one of the commonly used the CNN benchmarks to do power estimation, for example. To do power estimation, you will be running a one frame of ResNet 50 for a given patch size. And you'll be extracting the switching activity, feeding your power estimation tools. However, this processing of of simulating a single frame might imply millions of simulation cycles. So even today's state-of-the-art simulation tools, this is quite challenging and time-consuming. This might be in the way of doing multiple iterations for doing power estimation with the realistic workloads. And if you want to target, because your use case is, for example, to do full HD processing, this adds another layer of complexity in your runtimes and the data that needs to be processed will be increased further. So this is another aspect of on your power estimation, the challenges might be you may see. So to achieve higher throughput, it's common to process multiple images simultaneously, either in pipeline mode or in batch mode. So this might imply that you might need to process multiple frames such that the system gets to steady state. And for power estimation, you need to be simulating multiple frames and zooming in the right activity window and extracting the switching activity and feeding again to your simulation power estimation tools. As you have seen that in a one frame and doing the simulation on that one frame is already challenging for power estimation and simulation tools. Taking too many frames is definitely makes it not feasible. You have to consider introducing actually emulation-based power estimation to deal with such a challenging workloads. One of the common approaches to overcome these simulation challenges is to use short tests, synthetic benchmarks, for example, using a single convolution layer and to do power estimation based on it and to extract and actually project the full CNN graph layer. While this is helping you to get an estimation overcome these challenges, it might be also giving optimistic results and therefore misleading for results that you'll be getting when you're running actually a real application. There are a number of reasons that why this results might be diverging. For example, we talked about the importance of Mac utilization when it comes to power estimation. So for single layer, for example, that might be assumption that it has a very high Mac utilization, which might not be constant across different layers in a given graph and across different graphs. Another reason could be the input data distribution, which is affecting the power as well. For example, if you have more re-zeros per multiplication, your power consumption would be much lower. So having the a single layer, which might be actually masking these effects, therefore the divergent results compared to real applications. So you definitely need to ensure that is that you have a wide range application and you are doing actually the power estimation also on realistic workloads, such that there is no surprises at end. So we have seen the importance of input stimuli and the how it's affecting the quality of the results. There are other aspects that are orthogonal to the stimuli that is important when it comes to power estimation, the abstraction layer. So throughout the project, you'll be doing power estimation, actually multiple iterations of multiple power estimation at different abstraction levels. Starting from RTL, to synthesis level netlist and to the post layout netlist. Each of them has implications for accuracy, but also turnaround time and efforts. The turnaround time efforts also critical throughout the project timelines. So you have to apply the right methodologies and tools to do the right level of details. And then apply the right methods. So looking at the power RTL-based power estimation, it's key to start power estimation as early as possible. And by applying RTL-based power estimation, you'll be able to do faster iterations, give feedback to basically designs to improve as you are able to identify the power hotspots or catch the actual power bugs timely. And the faster iterations are key to keep the design being optimized either on hardware or interaction with software. While the iterations and turnaround times as fast, there is one thing that needs to be critically looked at is the accuracy compared to your sign-off results. The more that physical implementation details and incorporated in the tools, then your results will get more accurate. So if you would be doing a most approximate synthesis in the early estimation, you might your switching related power estimation might be underestimated. So the more that you do calibration, your estimation quality will also improve. But also that increases dependency on physical design details. While is doing these iterations faster and identifying issues earlier is important, you need to take this into account for comparison to your sign-off targets and to tracking your actual KPIs when it comes to power. As you move on to the next level of abstraction layer is that's the synthesis netlist-based power estimation. Here that you max step forward for accuracy and that you have memory placement in place and you have a notion of basically a clock tree as implementation. However, that is still not your final clock tree and your capacitance and therefore your overall the switching activity will be still have a number of percentages to different and lower compared to the sign-off runs that you'll be doing. So you have to take in this abstraction level also the getting more accurate, but then the turnaround time will also be slightly increasing. As you move to the next level of power estimation accuracy, that will be based on the post-layout netlist. In this case, you get the most accurate power estimation because your design will be complete as close to silicon, having the information about of capacitance, wire load, and the clock tree. And so all the timing information and the related things will be complete. So while making this accurate, Of course, at NOV, these designs are physically large, so the turnaround time and efforts to actually to get the full cycle completed will be also much slower. So if you compare to RTL-based power estimation, while getting it accurate is good, accurate and late feedback to design is also not good enough. So you have to actually have the applying the right methods and right tools at the different times and needs of the maturity of the design. But it's key to have the post-layout netlist related results, because that's going to be the bring you the closest KPI targets and be able to track if you're on close to your power budget or not. So each abstraction level has as a purpose, and the early RTL power estimation is required to improve your design, find the issues, and then be timely improving it. As your design matures, then you will be moving to the next level of abstraction levels, and need to actually mix of these methodologies across the project timelines. I have to the accuracy of these things you need to take into account to make sure that you're tracking with the right level of details and accuracy when it comes to sign-off targets. If we put sum this up of running different benchmarks from real applications and different applications where energy efficiency might be changing, and combining with the different accuracy levels, you will actually get different numbers for the same IP architecture. So you need to know actually what you quote if it comes to the evaluating a given energy efficiency of a design. So each and every factor has impact on the quality of the results. So we have discussed the number of challenges when it comes to power estimation. So let's look at the a number of best practices to help in handling these challenges. So it's clear that when it comes to estimating and validating and comparing the energy efficiency of a given design, there is no one single metrics or criteria to look at. So you have to look at the number of them to make it complete and realistic. The bandwidth you need to be aware of, because that has impact on power. The performance you need to be linking to a system performance you need to link it to power. The stimuli is affecting the power of the accuracy of the results, MAC utilization, and process conditions. So there's a number of factors that actually that needs to be put together to be comprehensive and complete as much as possible. As it goes to any system design, it is key from the beginning defining your use cases, applications, and the number of requirements for these applications that you care. That your performance requirements and your bandwidth requirements, and what is your power budget across these potentially varying applications under these constraints. It's key to have it in place and defined, well-defined and comprehensively for the next steps. If you're planning to enhance your design by introducing third-party IP vendors, it's key to ask the right questions and be comprehensive as much as possible. So you need to be asking the questions about the applications that you care, because getting benchmarking data on an application on running actually maybe not realistic image sizes, frames, that might not be useful. So you need to know about also the benchmarking conditions stated, like the technology, the frequency, process node, these sort of things that are the baseline, and the specific system performance, frames per second. What is the utilization, the MAC utilization, which is also impacting the overall results. And to give more meaning to the accuracy of the results, What is the estimation method, the methods are used while doing a power estimation? And the other aspect is, if it is matters to your application, what is the image size it's used? Is it a full HD or a very small patch size? This affects also the results as well. And the final thing, especially very key on the system context, is the DDR power. Because while a standard IP power might be meaning one thing, because of the choices, implications of the hardware, actually that an overall power might be bigger because of required accesses to DRAM. So you need to take these things into account. The quality of results in the power estimation is also defined by the workload. The recommendation is to do actually running realistic workloads and doing power estimation based on that. So it's important to do software-driven power analysis to run CNN graphs and the various actually applications and do the power estimation based on that. So this is how it will enable to get more realistic figures for your design. So while there is the need of doing a software-based power estimation, there is the need to be also overcoming the simulation challenges. This is that you need to be introducing emulation-based running workloads, and this will allow you to run any graphs and running multiple frames, as mentioned, that it will be common to do that will not be challenged in this approach. So to continue on doing realistic workloads and doing power estimation on the most accurate way, it's also recommended to have in your flow to introduce emulation-based power estimation. This can be combined with the different abstraction levels, but considering the importance of the sign-off power and tracking that, it's important to actually do post-layout netlist-based also power estimation, such that you know if you're hitting your KPIs and you're in your power budget. So it's important to do the power estimation in this way as well. Power should not be an afterthought. That's why it's important to start doing power estimation right from the beginning. Right, start with defining your use cases, targets, but also then after that, using the right approaches and the methods combined with different abstraction layers, track it, doing multiple iterations across the product development cycle. By doing so, that you'll be flagging issues timely and you'll be able to fix it and improve it also on time. And once you get to the end of the project, then hopefully you'll be on your in your power budget. As important as it is to design high performance, it is also key to fitting your power budget and actually that design for high energy efficient systems. To be able to do that, you need to doing a good job in doing power estimation. And as seen, as important it is also difficult to do the power estimation as there are many factors affecting it. The success of a product and the failure is when it comes to getting it right to power estimation, having something that a product that is in with the power budget versus something is on the field is causing issues. That there are a number of things that you need to be taking into account. And this varies from architectural considerations to implementation choice and how you choose the IP vendor, how you apply the methodologies, how you track it. This all actually is going to bring to you to successful product development. If you do all those things, checkbox ticks, hopefully that will be on the side of a successful product. This brings me to the end of my presentation. There are a number of questions that came up throughout the presentation. I'll try to address some of them. And if I'm not able to address now, that we'll try to follow up later on. One of the questions that comes up is if there are specific benchmarks that are recommended to do the power estimation for this domain. Give an example of Reset 50, but this is one of the benchmarks, maybe not might be, let's say, the latest and not exposing actually complexity or actually efficiency of a given design. So your recommendation is to use latest benchmarks. For example, look at the efficient net and extend it further with the evolving actually applications. Another question is, when is the best time actually to introduce emulation in your flow? I think this is more about when so it is important to run realistic workloads that impacts the quality of results, but at the same time, it also means that your design is mature enough to be able to such workload. So the moment that actually that you're able to run software and you have a clear definition of what you want to target to, then it's good to kick off the emulation-based power estimation. Another question is about if there are other metrics other than TOPS per watt, any other metrics can be recommended. TOPS per watt is a good metric to start with. However, for example, the could recommend to use also millijoule per frame as another different metric to look at. Basically, this states the energy consumed in a processing in frame at a certain system performance, for example, so much of frames per second, and within a given fixed image size, a frame size. So this actually combines multiple aspects, but it's actually the other effect of it that you can easily scale to different performance metrics and therefore different energy efficiency levels by using these metrics. Another question is it good enough to do only average power during your power estimation? There's a lot of focus that I think I mentioned is indeed focusing on the average power and the estimation around it. But there are other aspects such as the glitch power and the peak power that needs to be analyzed. And these effects actually might is key actually that for example, if, peak power is about your if your power grid is dimensioned right or not. And glitch power, that's other aspects that it comes in, like is these things that does your design actually can cope with this, and is it again within your power budget or not? So you need to extend actually your power estimation and validation taking these aspects as well. I think this addressed a number of questions, and the remaining questions that that we'll try to follow up offline. I hope this was a useful session. Thank you.